Good evening. Tonight, every expense spared, guests include Paul Jones and the Blues Band, the author of the book more frequently stolen from public libraries throughout the world than any other, that's Norris McWhirter, and four gentlemen who will be discussing a controversial film inspired by the New Testament. Only yesterday, in The Scotsman, a prominent news item headed New Superstar Row revealed that the film Jesus Christ Superstar has this week been banned from a cinema in the Western Isles as blasphemous, a curse placed on another remote Scottish cinema which dared to screen Superstar in 1976, led to the recent closure of that particular house of entertainment. If Superstar still has this trouble nearly 10 years after its creation, what hope does Monty Python's Life of Brian have today? Soon, the opinions of John Cleese, Michael Palin, Malcolm Muggeridge and Mervyn Stockwood, the Bishop of Southwark. Here's a moderately controversial clip from the film. That extract featured Graham Chapman as Brian and Terry Jones, who also directed the picture, as Mandy, mother of Brian. With us tonight, another one-third of Monty Python, John Cleese and Michael Palin.
BBC cutbacks.
Michael, why the name Brian?
Well, I don't know. We've always used Brian in Python to portray a certain sort of character, fairly anonymous, and I apologise to anyone called Brian, slightly sort of...
I mean, there's a good chance of...
dim. No, not dim. That's not fair. It's slow to catch on.
And there's a fighting chance of at least one Brian watching tonight, so
well,
be careful.
I don't know. Have you seen the figures? Cheap, wasn't it cheap? No, actually, John was in a sketch about a footballer being interviewed in one of the very early Python shows, and it was all Brian.
Yeah,
there was a ball in the back
right.
of the net, Brian.
I'm opening a boutique, Brian. But it's all, it's one of the funny names, isn't it? It's like Trevor and Kevin. I mean, they're just funny.
What inspired the film Life of Brian? I mean, how did that strange idea take root in, and indeed in whose skull did it take root?
Well, we're not exactly certain. It's always difficult to find the exact moment when it came up. But I know that when we were going around the world sort of doing premieres for the Holy Grail, and we had a lot of time to spare in airports and cafes and restaurants, and we got to thinking about a new film and what particular area we might go in. And we were still keen to do a historical film. I said, you know, more fun dressing up and all that. We'd done the Bowler Hatted City Gents on Python. And I think it was Eric who came up with this title out of the blue called Jesus Christ, Lust for Glory. And I must admit that when we started talking about it, we actually explored the idea of doing a comedy film about Jesus, you know, with all the jokes about someone trying to book a table for 12 at the Last Supper. Sorry, sir, you know, Saturday night, I'll do you 3-4s. Come in tomorrow, no, it's got to be tonight, and all those jokes. But the more that we read about Jesus and the background to his life, it was quite obvious that there was very little to ridicule in Jesus' life. And therefore, we were sort of onto a loser. The characters we like to portray in Python are failures, are dim, are idiotic, are sort of incapable in one way or another. Jesus was a straight, direct man, so making very good sense. And so we decided that we'd be very, sort of just a rather shallow film just about Jesus. So we got Brian in.
You must have known, though, that even in those early days, you were heading for trouble and criticism and controversy. A, because you were well known. B, because, you know, to put it mildly, the subject matter is quite well known.
Yeah, I don't know.
Did that worry you?
I mean, I feel that Python, that's, we've always thrived on that. It's always been a bit of an uphill struggle.
So what came first? Was it the laughter idea or the message? I mean, which was the first of the two that...
It's the laughter. We go for the jokes first. I mean, the reason that it sounded like an interesting territory to go into, to explore, because when you go in there, you really don't know what you're going to write. I mean, we usually sit around for about 3 days discussing theoretically what we're going to write, and then we go around and write something completely different. And the film actually starts when somebody comes in halfway through the second week and reads something out, and we all laugh. And that's the first point on the graph. Yeah. Do you see what I mean?
Yes,
and then we may wait another week, and then somebody else
writes
something funny, and then we have 2 points on the graph. And when we've got about 6 or 7, we start writing stuff to join it together. It's a pretty slow process because it's sort of democracy gone mad.
It took a long time for Brian to really get off the ground. We wrote an awful lot, which was then just thrown away because it was sort of struggling too hard to be sort of controversial.
Mike, that, I don't know. I agree with that because I don't think that we were coming in with stuff about Christ. Mm. We all started writing about around the edges, all the people who'd arrived 5 minutes after the miracle had been done. No, which is as bad as being 2,000 years late. The point is, if you didn't see it, you know, it doesn't matter whether you're 5 minutes late or whatever. Actually, we did have the idea that he was the 13th disciple, didn't we? A sort of slight hanger-on.
Right, yes.
Yes, that's right. He was going to write a gospel, but he was always late.
Because it was also called Brian of Nazareth at one point, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And yet you changed that title, yet that would have worked, wouldn't it, for this movie or not?
Well, I think, I always thought that title somehow asked for the comparison with Jesus of Nazareth, you know, the Powell thing, too much. It looked as though we were going for the comparison.
But you apparently used Lou Grade's sets that he used on Jesus of Nazareth. Didn't you, in fact, use the same scenario?
The ones he hadn't taken down. We used them for building our own sets in. There was temples there in Monastir, in this place in Tunisia.
At one stage we were looking for about, I think there were 5 or 6 different places we might have shot it. Italy, Spain, Jordan, Israel, Morocco, Tunisia. Yeah. And I think we decided Tunisia eventually, partly because we thought there might be religious trouble in the Catholic countries, and partly because we discovered they'd be making a lot of films in the last 2 or 3 years in Tunisia. And then when you sort of say, we'll get the rushes here in the morning, you don't arrive and find there's a lot of rushes there. You know,
there's practically an industry over there of making films about Jesus, because Rossellini had made a film. Then Lou Grade had been there for a couple... Rossellini, an Italian director, made a film about Jesus. Then, well, I don't know.
I missed that.
He thought it was a footballer, didn't he?
No, I thought it was a food.
Yeah, FC. Turin. No, Rossellini made this film, and then I thought it was rather good.
Is he good, Rossellini?
Yeah, he's a bit slow. He worked the second half. He was very good. Hit the ball, and there it was in the back of the stand.
If he's watching, I'm terribly sorry, but I've never heard of the guy.
Well,
He's made a film. Has it come out?
He's made a film about Jesus. And it came out, yes, I think so.
Well, the extraordinary thing is, Tim, I don't know all the facts of this because I was only told this about 4 days ago, but apparently there are now four, quote, funny, unquote, films about the Bible coming out the next 3 months.
As a result of Brian,
well,
or just coincidentally?
Well, I don't know. It may just be coincidence. Mm. Mind you, we've been talking about it on and off for 3 years, so maybe the idea sort of filtered into somebody else's.
How did the whole thing get together? Because you had this great idea in an airport lounge or wherever, and still you have a fairly long way to go from, you know, Terminal 2 to screens all over the world.
It was a very big airport. It was ages.
Well, it is that pragmatic thing.
Because you had trouble with the cash and backers pulling out.
Oh, yeah. Terrible trouble, yes. In fact, if George Harrison hadn't known Eric Idle, the film wouldn't have been made. Mm. Because although the Americans, I mean, after the EMI thing fell through, we then went to America.
What happened, John?
I didn't say
fell through?
Fell through. Oh. Fell through. Failed to happen, as it were. We then went to America, and they were all prepared to give us a little bit of money, but not enough, not as much as we needed to make the film. So we needed, I think, $2.5 million to make it for the American territories, and they wouldn't give us more than 1¾. So come the middle of the year, we suddenly realised we weren't going to make it. And then out of the blue, John Goldstone, the producer, said, well, I've got one more meeting with George Harrison. And George Harrison, which I think is really one of the great, almost magnificent acts of the century, said he was quite happy to put up £1 million for no other reason, apparently, he wanted to see the movie.
Right. It's true, yeah.
Weren't you all in some danger of splitting up or at least some internal conflict? Did the film, in fact, bring you together?
Yes, I mean, I think it did. After The Grail, there was about a year spent sort of in the wilderness, as it were. No one quite sure what they wanted to do. And people going off to try and do their own things, Fawlty Towers or Ripping Yarns or whatever.
Also, there was a stage when we hated each other.
Well, I never hated you, John. Whatever any of the others may say, I always liked you.
What about your solo projects? I mean, are there going to be any more Ripping Yarns, any more Fawlty Towers?
There'll be no more Fawlty Towers.
He sent me a wonderful telegram last week when I had my 40th birthday, and it read, "We love the first 40, stop. Are you going to do any more?"
You got it right.
Well, are you? I mean, is there going to be a...
I don't think so, no. I feel we've done that, just as I felt about Python and the telly, that you actually reach a point and then it's the law of diminishing returns. You could go on.
And does that mean there won't be any more Pythons on the telly?
Highly unlikely at the moment.
But not
highly
totally
well, not
ruled
totally.
Out.
I mean, I don't think anything is absolutely, definitely ruled out.
I tell you what I hate, and that's the sausage machine. And you get into it. Yes. The moment you sign on the dotted line, 13 shows, that's 8 months in the diary, filming, editing, rehearsing. It's much nicer to take one two-hour or hour and a half thing, like a film, and spend a lot of time, and then you can savour it and explore and do a lot of talking, which is much better than having to get everything written every day.
See, Johns gets very oppressed by work, you see, doesn't like work. And what I feel about the Python shows is that actually I don't know where we would start off. I think we almost did everything in those three series, and I just don't know how
I mean,
we'd
begin
practically
again. Doing it tonight, because we were saying in the dressing room, you know, I mean, it's terribly funny. It suddenly struck us that here we are, you know, in a Bishop and Malcolm Muggeridge are going to come on, you know.
In the studio tonight.
Yes.
You know, and it's not a sketch.
Yeah. It may be, John.
Are you implying that possibly there might be a third or fourth, rather, Python movie, a full-length film? This is certainly on the cards.
Yes, in fact, we're supposed to be meeting, aren't we? November the 19th?
Monday week,
your place?
Yes.
to discuss this very thing. I think it's very likely that we'll do another film.
But we want to see if there's an area that nobody's gone into, really. You see, because the one thing about this film, I mean, I really like it, and there's a lot of stuff we've done I don't like that much. But I really like this film. And there are moments when I watch it, and I think, I haven't seen anything like this before on the screen.
Is there anything that you think could offend you on screen?
I mean,